breezes in the greenhouse unless you brush against it. Many greenhouse producers will have some type of a little gadget that agitates the blossoms to get that pollen onto the female portion of the plant.
Okay, very good. We'll be back in another few minutes with some more of your questions. Give us a call. Right now, some more in the garden.
The coal crops are all members of the plant family Cruciferae. This includes cabbage, cauliflower, broccoli, kohlrabi, kale, and Brussels sprouts. Cabbage is a popular crop for home gardens. It is a biennial, although it is grown as an annual crop. There are a lot of variations between types of cabbage and varieties. They vary in size, shape, color, and the texture of the leaves and heads. The Savoy cabbage has crinkled, textured leaves. The quality of the Savoy head is considered superior to other types of cabbage. This variety is Savoy Ace Hybrid. It produces large, solid heads. Chinese cabbage has a slightly different flavor and texture than typical garden cabbage. It grows best in Iowa if it's planted in July for a fall crop to mature when the temperatures are cooler. Kale is a relative of cabbage and is relatively easy to grow. This particular variety is used as an ornamental for borders and flower or vegetable gardens. It is also edible. Cauliflower can be a difficult crop for home gardens because of the many variables that affect it. As you know, cauliflower requires blanching to produce a quality head. This, along with other factors, need to be considered when growing cauliflower. Some plants, such as cauliflower and broccoli, require a process known as vernalization, which is the induction of flowering due to low temperatures. In order for flowering to occur, there needs to be oxygen available, water, a growing point on the plant, cold temperatures, and food reserves. Broccoli and cauliflower require very little chilling for vernalization. They flower readily if all the criteria for vernalization is met. This is important to know when growing or selecting broccoli and cauliflower transplants. For example, a small cauliflower transplant set out in early spring may have the oxygen, water, growing point, and cool environment required for flowering. However, it will not flower or produce a head at that time because it lacks the necessary food reserves. On the other hand, if a large cauliflower transplant is set out in early spring and receives all the necessary requirements, including cool temperatures, it may form a head prematurely because it has an adequate amount of food reserves. A large transplant growing in mid-July will not form a head because the temperatures are too warm for vernalization. On account of this, broccoli and cauliflower can be planted in mid to late summer for a fall crop. Again, it is important to grow or select proper sized transplants. Select those that are rather small in size and are not crowded in the flat. Buttoning is the term used to describe this premature head formation in cauliflower. As you know, to produce a high quality white cauliflower, the heads need to be blanched or covered. There are cauliflower varieties available that are supposed to be self-blanching. The leaves of these varieties are more erect and will shade the head. However, in warm weather, the leaves tend to droop and may expose the heads so that they need to be blanched even though they are regarded as self-blanching. Brussels sprouts are also a member of this plant family. They are relatively easy to grow. When planted in the spring, they will begin producing sprouts in midsummer and continue into late fall. Kohlrabi is an interesting coal crop. The edible portion is the swollen stem. It has a mild turnip cabbage-like flavor. They can be direct seeded into the garden or started indoors as transplants. Kohlrabi should be planted 4 to 6 inches apart in the garden and harvested when still tender. Kohlrabi can be planted for an early summer harvest or and again in the fall for a fall crop. Everyone who has grown a coal crop is familiar with the pesky cabbage worms. If left untreated, a lot of cabbage end up looking like coleslaw while they are still in the garden. There are two common insects responsible for leaf feeding damage to cabbages. Together, they are called cabbage worms. Both caterpillars cause similar damage and are managed in similar fashion. The first caterpillar is called the imported cabbage worm. It's a fuzzy green caterpillar with a velvety texture. The caterpillars feed on leaves through the summer, eating irregular large holes. This troublesome but yet common caterpillar is the immature stage of the cabbage butterfly. Most of us love to see butterflies. However, they're not in your garden just sipping nectar. They're out there laying eggs on the undersides of the leaves. There are several generations of these caterpillars throughout the summer. The second caterpillar that attacks cabbages is called the cabbage looper. It walks with a looping motion and is frequently called an inchworm. The cabbage looper is light green with thin white lines running down lengthwise. It also has several generations per year. Cabbage loopers and imported cabbage worms do the very same damage, and often at the same time on the same plant. There are many home remedies of questionable efficacy that are used for controlling cabbage worms. Some of them include sprinkling wood ashes, flour, or other powder on the plants. As with many home remedies, these remain untested, but are popular tactics endorsed with numerous testimonials. The same can be said for companion plantings around cabbage family plants. Only in this case, there is some scientific test evidence showing that companion planting does not prevent cabbage worm problems, and in fact, they may make the caterpillar problem worse. Bug juice is a popularized organic technique with little rational basis for expecting the instant thorough control as reported in testimonials. Bug juice is made by blending any offending insect with water and spraying the strained solution onto plants. Besides being repulsive, this method did not work. It provided no cabbage worm control when done in a replicated experiment at Iowa State in 1979. Several home garden insecticides are labeled for cabbage worm control, but the one we strongly recommend is Bacillus thuringiensis. This selective insecticidal bacterium works very well against leaf-feeding caterpillars. The dust or spray should be applied weekly when cabbage worms are present. Demonstration gardens at four Iowa locations in 1982 tested several cabbage worm control tactics, such as wood ashes, cheesecloth barriers, and companion plants. All the non-chemical techniques and companion plants were not effective in controlling the cabbage worms in our test gardens. The BT and 7 sprays were highly effective. Aphids are small insects that are also commonly found on cabbage and other coal crops. But unlike the cabbage worms, aphids do not cause a lot of damage. In most situations, vegetable plants that are healthy, vigorous, and properly maintained can tolerate a lot of aphids with no apparent loss of yields or quality. There are hundreds of species of aphids varying in color and size. It is important to remember that most aphids are host plant specific and will feed on one or maybe a few kinds of plants. There are exceptions, but generally the aphids found on vegetables are not the same species as those found on trees, and populations will not move from one host plant to another unrelated plant. Most garden insecticides are effective against aphids. However, several natural controls, such as lady beetles, tend to suppress aphid populations. These natural controls, including weather and predators, will allow some aphids to survive, but will often keep populations below the injury level. Two simple, non-chemical tactics can supplement natural controls. Washing aphids from an infested plant with a forceful stream of water can dislodge a significant portion. Aphids lack any intelligence or sense of direction, and it's unlikely that they will find their way back to the plant after being washed off. The other control alternative is to poison the aphids with soapy water. Aphids and other soft-bodied insects are susceptible to soapy water sprays applied directly to them. A detergent spray made with 5 to 6 tablespoons of liquid detergent per gallon of water applied in your compressed air sprayer or a hand spray bottle will be fatal to aphids. We're not sure why this works, but we do know detergents are poisonous to soft-bodied insects. Liquid dishwashing detergents are preferred for this use because of their ease of mixing and safety to plant foliage. Laundry powders could be used, or a special insecticidal detergents can be purchased. Another problem many gardeners have when growing coal crops, as well as beans and peas, is rabbits. They can be a nuisance to gardeners in the city or in the country. There are many home remedies to keep rabbits out of the garden. However, the most sure way is to put up a barrier, such as a 2-foot-high chicken wire fence around the garden. Rabbits are more likely to attempt to burrow under the fence than to jump over it, so it's a good idea to bury the bottom 2 or 3 inches of the fence. The next plant family we're going to look at is the large one, the legume family, which includes garden beans and peas. Among home garden vegetables, beans are second only to tomatoes in popularity. Snap beans include yellow, green, and purple potted varieties. The yellow potted beans are sometimes referred to as wax beans. The purple potted beans turn green when they're cooked. Besides snap beans, there are several other types of beans grown in home gardens. This is the flat potted Romano type bean. They have a flavor all their own and are especially good for slicing into French cut beans. The asparagus beans are not related to asparagus and are only distant cousins to garden beans. They are actually a runner or a climbing type of cowpea or southern pea. These scarlet runner beans can be eaten, however, they are more often grown for their ornamental masses of scarlet blooms and are high climbing runners. These are horticultural beans, sometimes referred to as shelly beans. They are grown for their seeds because the pods become stringy at a young age. Lima beans can be grown in Iowa with variable success. The recommended varieties for our area are Ford Hook and Baby Ford Hook. Edible soybeans are a novelty item in home gardens. They are grown for their high content of vegetable oil and protein. Edible soybeans resemble field-grown soybeans. However, the edible soybeans have a better flavor and texture. Peas are a popular garden crop, although they do require a lot of space in the garden for the amount of edible produce harvested. There are several good varieties recommended for our area. Another type of pea is the edible potted pea, sometimes called the snow pea. They differ from standard garden peas in that the pods are harvested before the seeds develop. The snap peas are a type of edible potted pea. Gardeners were introduced to snap peas with the variety Sugar Snap, which was an All-America Award winner in 1980. Since then, snap peas have become very popular, and there have been several other snap pea varieties introduced to the market. Snap peas can be harvested at all stages of development, even when the seeds in the pods are large. They are more efficient in the garden because they provide more yield per foot of row than standard peas that require shelling. The next group of plants we are going to discuss do not belong to the same plant family, but have similar cultural requirements, the root crops. They are quite a diverse group. With the exception of turnips and parsnips and carrots, most of the root crops are short season crops which can be planted 2 or more times in the garden. Early flowering or bolting is one of the problems we have when growing some root crops. For example, carrots are biennial and require an accumulated amount of exposure to low temperatures for bolting to occur. However, if spring and summer months are cool, carrots may flower the first season. The carrot flower resembles the Queen Anne's lace because they are close relatives. Carrots that develop a seed stock should be discarded because they become very strong and bitter flavored. Early planted radishes bolt readily in the summer as the day length increases. As a result, they should be planted at staggered times in the spring and then replanted at various times again in late summer. An unusual crop that is quite easy to grow is salsify, sometimes referred to as oyster plant because of its mild oyster-like flavor. Salsify, or salsafy, is directed seeded into the spring and harvested in the fall. It can be mulched over and left in the garden throughout the winter and harvested the following February or March. Some gardeners claim the flavor actually improves when they are left in the ground and subjected to the freezing and thawing. Parsnips can also be left in the garden all winter if covered with a mulch and harvested before growth resumes the following spring. Like the root crops, the salad or leafy vegetables are several unrelated crops grouped together because of their similar cultural requirements. Lettuce is one of the first crops to be harvested from the garden. There are several different types and varieties of lettuce available. Lettuce requires a cool growing season, so it should be planted for an early spring harvested and again for a fall crop. Lettuce readily bolts when subjected to high temperatures, and it has a very shallow root system, so it does not tolerate drought conditions. There are four distinct types of lettuce. They are known as head, leaf or cutting, cos or romaine, and stem lettuce. There are two classes of head lettuce, known as crisp head and butterhead. Leaf lettuce is probably the most common type grown in home gardens. There are several varieties available, such as the red sales and oak leaf, as you see here. Leaf lettuce produces a good crop when direct seeded into the garden. The crisp head lettuce varieties, those like we purchase at the grocery store, are not widely grown in Iowa because of our cool spring season is not long enough. There are varieties available that are recommended for home gardens and can be grown fairly successfully. They perform best if started indoors and set out as transplants 3 to 4 weeks old early in the season. This variety is Mission. It produces a small but good quality head. The bib or butterhead lettuce produces a looser head. The leaves are darker green than the crisp head varieties and have a good flavor. The butterhead varieties, such as this butter crunch, perform better in home gardens than the crisp head types. It is best to plant them as transplants or thin direct seeded plants to 6 inches between the plants. The other two types of lettuce are the romaine and the stem types. Stem lettuce is not commonly grown in home gardens in the Midwest. The romaine lettuce produces large, tall, crisp heads resembling Chinese cabbage. These are immature romaine plants set out as transplants early in the season. Unlike other types of lettuce, the romaine lettuce can be grown for a spring and fall crop. Endive is a cool season vegetable, similar to lettuce, and is very attractive in salads. It is used primarily as a garnish or added to salads for texture. It has a stronger flavor than lettuce, and like lettuce, it bolts under high temperatures. Spinach is the most important pot herb or green grown in the United States. It thrives in relatively cool weather and will withstand freezing better than most vegetables. Spinach bolts when subjected to long days, so it actually grows best as a fall crop in Iowa because the days get shorter and the temperatures are cooler. New Zealand spinach was introduced to home gardeners as an alternative to the typical garden spinach because it did not readily bolt in the summer. The leaves of New Zealand spinach are smaller and thicker.
It looks like spring, at least when you watch that. And it's really fun, Linda, to see gardens this time of year. And it's wonderful to have all that footage and show people what it looks like and remind them that it will be springtime soon.
That's right, and we were just talking, a lot of the home and garden shows are going on now, and mm-hmm. it's fun to see these fresh plants growing
it
again,
is.
Especially when it's zero or below zero outside.
You bet. We've got lots of good questions. Let's get right to them. From Lynn County, what's the best way of dealing with bacterial wilt of cantaloupes and cucumbers?
Both are very susceptible to bacterial wilt, and the only way you're going to control them is to control the cucumber beetles that feed on them, because it is the striped and spotted cucumber beetles that transmit the disease. It overwinters in their gut. They emerge in the spring, start feeding, and infect instantly your plants as they feed, and that can be just as soon as those seedlings emerge. So the best time to control them, if you've had problems in the past, is immediately after seedling emergence. Go ahead and spray, or keep them well dusted if you prefer to dust. but at that point to control the beetles.
Okay. Another question a little bit like that one from Mary Clark in Vinton. When should you start treating for cucumber beetles if you've had a problem before? When should you start your insecticide treatment?
Well, the beetles will find the seedlings immediately after they emerge. So the best thing to do is to watch your garden carefully. And some gardeners claim that their cucumber beetles will attack the seedlings even before they're up out of the ground. So you've got to be very careful. Now, I appreciate the fact that some of the people in the audience are organic gardeners, and they'd like some other recommendations besides insecticide sprays. There are products on the market now, floating row covers, Remay, Agronet, these products that can be applied over the row. They float over the row. What I would suggest, however, is use hoops, because a little of that abrasion with the wind can damage the plant. So put hoops over your row. They only have to be about a foot to 2 feet off the ground, stretched about 3 foot wide over the row, and then put the Remay over the row, and then secure it on all sides with soil to prevent it from blowing away and from the beetles from crawling under or the other pests. This has to be removed, however, early June to prevent, to allow the honeybees to pollinate these crops. But I think a Remay might help for early control of beetles and other pests, because the infection period, it takes a while for the infection to take place, or to show symptoms, I should say. So if we take the Remay off middle part of June, first part of June, as soon as the blossoms start to appear, then if the beetles feed, the infection may attack or come on a little bit later.
Okay.
And we'll get a crop.
Okay. Jim Freer from Washington calls and asks about something that I have never tried, and that's can squash and pumpkin blossoms be produced for eating, deep frying, that sort of thing? That's not that unusual, I suppose.
No, it's not. There are places and cultures that they do grow these crops, particularly for their blossoms. They bread them or they fat fry them. There is a new variety, and I believe it's Burpee Company that has it out in their catalog.
Really?
That they have a squash that you don't grow for the squash, you grow specifically for the blossoms that you'll then prepare. So you might want to check your Burpee seed catalog, and I don't recall the variety name of that particular squash, but it's in the front of their catalog. It's their new release, and it's specific for growing cucumbers, or excuse me, it's a squash for the blossom.
Very good. And another question from Mary Clark in Vinton. Is there really that much difference between pickling and slicing cucumbers?
There is. There is. If you look in the catalogs, they distinctly specify for pickling or for slicing. The small gherkin types are particularly bred for pickling, because after the pickles go through the process, you want to retain a crisp texture. You don't want them to get flabby or limp. You don't want to lose the color. You don't want to lose the flavor. So these varieties have been bred through channels and down the breeding process so that we get a pickle that's crisp, that doesn't lose its texture, and that retains its flavor and color. So yes, it is very important when you're growing dill pickles or tiny sweet pickles to choose a variety that is specific for that purpose.
Okay, and the slicing cucumbers have that smooth skin.
That's right.
And they really are quite different, of course, than the pickling cucumbers.
You can harvest them when they're small. Some people will plant a slicing variety, harvest them when they're 2 to 3 inches long, and use them for pickles. The quality is probably not as good using it that way as using a good pickling variety.
Okay. What steps can be taken to get large onions in this question from Scott County?
We get that question a lot. I think many gardeners base their gardening ability on how large they can grow their onions. A lot of it has to do with the specific variety they grow. There are certain varieties that will grow extremely large, but you can't expect any onion variety to produce an onion 3 inches in diameter if you only give it an inch to grow in. One of the key secrets is to give it plenty of room to grow. Plant early and harvest when the tops die down. This is critical. And give it plenty of space. Some old-time recommendations say mound the onions to get larger onions. This is not necessary. The commercial growers don't mound their onions, and they still get good quality, good size. So the best thing to do is keep the bulb covered so that we don't get a lot of greening tissue on the top of the bulb, but don't let the soil wash completely away, or don't go ahead and mound it like you would a leek. Plant spacing is very important, and plenty of moisture, and a good loose soil works very well. Onions will not enlarge very fast if we have the problem of tight soils.
Okay, and just because your onions are small doesn't mean you're not a good gardener.
That's right.
Okay. Here's a very similar question from Patty in Johnson County. Does bending over the tops, the onion tops, make the bulb increase in size?
No, and we get that question a lot because somehow out in the literature they recommended that at one time or another. If you recall, plants grow. It's the nutrients coming down from the leaves and the foliage that produces the carbohydrates in our storage organ, which is our onion bulb. Well, if we interrupt that movement of photosynthates down from the leaves and into the bulb, we're not going to get that movement, and so we're not going to get bulb enlargement. I think that's probably the most easy way to describe why that doesn't happen. Okay. When we knock the tops over, we're maturing our onions in the sense that we're allowing that outside layer to develop a nice papery sheath to protect the onion in storage.
Okay, another onion question. This one from Scott County. This is a good question, I think. Gentleman wants to spread out planting of the onion plants, in other words, about 15 every week. How do you store the sets so that you can plant them over a long period of time?
That's a good question. I've never heard that done, but it's probably a good practice. Well, you'd want to keep those onion sets cool. Probably the best place would be your refrigerator so that they're just above the freezing temperature so they don't initiate sprouts. I think it's the sprouting that this person is trying to control. So keep them cool. Don't keep them in your garage between plantings. Keep them in a refrigerator.
Okay. Question from Linn County about another question about black walnut. This always comes up. People have lots of questions about how long are the roots toxic after the tree is cut.
Yeah, we mentioned that before, but I'd like to repeat it because this is a point of interest for a lot of people that perhaps have never heard of this toxicity problem, or they may have their neighbor's tree that's creating a problem for them. The black walnut tree roots will remain in the soil perhaps 7 years before totally being decomposed. So this estimates are 7 years after the tree has been cut down that you may still find traces. Although year after year, the concentration of the toxin in the soil will be reduced. So perhaps after a couple years of tilling around that area, and the product will be, the toxin will have bleached through.
Jim Kuhlman in Mason City has a neighbor with a walnut tree and obviously can't cut down his neighbor's tree. Are there crops that can be planted close to a walnut tree?
Well, you don't want any crops growing in the shade of a tree. Probably the ones to avoid would be easier than to say the ones that can be grown. The ones to avoid are the Solanaceae crops. Once again, those are the tomatoes, peppers, eggplants, and potatoes. I would also avoid growing strawberries or apple trees in this area because some people have found that these plants are also affected by the walnut tree toxin.
Okay, are the trees toxic or a problem to corn and beans?
No.
Okay.
No.
Except for the shade.
The shading and the root competition, but the toxin will not affect their growth.
Okay. From Linn County, have Iowans had any success in growing potatoes in patio barrels? So what are good cultural practices in this situation?
That's similar, very similar to the idea of growing them in the tire.
In tires, yeah.
It's done. It can be done. Again, you've got to use a good loose potting soil. Don't go out into your garden and dig up soil because that becomes very compact. And moisture is a very critical factor. Anytime you're growing a plant in a container, the plant can't seek out water from the surrounding areas as if they're planted in the soil. So they only have that limited water reserve within that barrel. Make sure you have good drainage, however, to allow excess water to flow through. What they do is they plant it fairly deep in the barrel. It's not fairly deep, but they don't fill the barrel completely full of soil to begin with. They plant their tuber about 4 inches deep. As that grows out, it won't get a lot of light, but it grows out. And then they continue to bury it. And so again, as they bury the stem, more stolons are developed. My prediction is that they'll probably result in a lot of small tubers.
Okay, little potatoes.
Right.
Okay, this next question is going to take us the next half day to answer. But anyway, how do I know when to water my garden?
Well, that's a good question.
When
it's dry. Generally, we recommend at least 1 inch of water per week through the growing season. During hot, dry weather, windy weather, I should say. We don't get a lot of hot, dry weather. Usually it's pretty humid here in Iowa. But hot, windy weather, we're going to have to water more frequently. A good test is if you can, when you hoe your garden, if you go down 3-4 inches and it's dry, I would get water on that garden very fast. 1 inch of water per week. Mulching is the best way probably to regulate the moisture level in your garden. Again, if you get an inch of rainfall, you don't have to irrigate that week. However, if you go a week or two and you don't get any rainfall, then I would go ahead and water.
Okay. We've gotten several calls from out of state, and that's fun, and we appreciate it very much. We will get to those questions a little bit later. But real quick, one from Mississippi about whether tapes of the shows will be available for purchase or rent. Yes, and we will tell you a little bit later on about where you can write to ask about the tapes. The rental or the purchase, I'm not sure about that. We'll have to check on that a little bit later. But we will be here 2 weeks from today at the same time and on the same transponder and channel on your satellite receiver. 2 weeks from today, that's the 27th, to talk about fruits. And if we don't have the information today about renting or purchasing tapes, we will in a couple of weeks. But yes, you can get a hold of tapes of this program. Let's break now.
That's exciting to hear people are
It is. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah, that's
One
great.
From Oregon we got a call, and that's really, really fun for us. And we'll answer your question after this next bit of business about vegetable gardening, and we'll look at that right now.
Fresh sweet corn is a favorite among Iowans. What makes sweet corn different from ordinary field corn is a single gene that prevents the usual change of sugar to starch as the kernels mature. The sweet corn kernel shrinks as it dries because it lacks a full cargo of starch. This is very obvious with the seed of the new extra sweet type sweet corn varieties. That's one reason it sprouts with less vigor than field corn. This is a stand of sweet corn planted at the same time as this field corn. Note the difference in vigor and stand. Corn is a monoecious plant with separate male and female flowers on the same plant. The tassels are the male flower and the silks are the female flower. Pollen is carried to the silks from the tassels by wind and gravity. Each silk is connected to an undeveloped kernel. If pollination is complete, the ear will be filled with the plump kernels. If not, there may be gaps or poor tip fill. Once fertilization occurs, the silks begin to dry and turn brown. For best pollination, it is important to plant in blocks of short rows rather than only one or two long rows. There are some relatively new sweet corn varieties that merit some attention. These are referred to as the sweeter or super sweet varieties. They are different because they retain their sweetness longer. Normal sweet corn varieties retain their top quality for only 1 or 2 days in the garden, then the sugar is quickly converted to starch. Also, standard sweet corn varieties do not store well after harvest. Sweet corn breeders have overcome these shortcomings with the new high sugar varieties by modifying genes or altering gene combinations within the plant. Two of this type are the sugary enhanced and shrunken 2 varieties. Both are much sweeter than the standard sweet corn varieties. The name shrunken 2 comes from the shrunken appearance of the dried kernels. These kernels have at least doubled the total sugars of normal sweet corn. And since they are slower to convert sugar to starch, the shrunken 2 types may be harvested and stored over a longer period of time. The sugary enhanced varieties are also sweeter at harvest and are slower to convert sugar to starch. They can be identified by the letters EH after the variety name. Although the high sugar types have a high eating quality and have a prolonged harvest and storage period, they are not without their problems. They tend to have poor seed vigor, and yields of the high sugar types are generally lower than the standard yellow varieties. While standard sweet corn varieties can be planted in late April in central Iowa, and the high sugar types should not be planted until mid-May. The seed has poor vigor under cool temperatures, cool soil temperatures, that is, resulting in low germination. Avoid planting these varieties when soil temperatures are below 55 degrees. Plant the seed shallow in moist soil, then water to keep the soil moist and promote germination. The shrunken 2 types must be isolated from sugary enhanced standard sweet corn and popcorn and field corn. Cross-pollination between the shrunken 2 and other sweet corn will destroy the quality of both. The kernels will be tough and starchy if cross-pollination occurs. pollen from field and popcorn will produce similar results. Isolation is necessary by planting the high sugar types at least 250 feet from other types of corn and by avoiding prevailing winds. Cross-pollination can be avoided by planting the various types so they mature at different times. There should be a minimum of 14 days between the different maturity dates. Excellent shrunken two varieties available include the Florida Stay Sweet, How Sweet It Is, and Summer Sweet. Popular EH varieties are Candy Corn EH and Tender Treat EH. One of the main pest problems to the sweet corn producer is raccoons. Unfortunately, they can be rather difficult to control. Several novel tactics have been tried, and their testimonials to their effectiveness have been published. However, the best proven way to keep raccoons out of the sweet corn patch is the use of an electric fence. This should consist of a wire strand placed 3 to 4 inches from the ground and 2 or 3 more wires at 6 to 12 inch intervals. If you've ever grown sweet corn, you've probably seen corn smut. This fungal disease produces gall-like masses on the plant. Smut galls may occur anywhere on the above-ground portion of the corn plant. Young smut galls are firm with solid white centers, but as the galls age, the center turns into masses of black powdery spores. Smut development is favored by dry conditions and temperatures between 79 and 94 degrees. For control, plant resistant varieties avoid mechanical injury to plants and maintain balanced fertility. Generally, the later producing, larger growing varieties tend to have less smut infection than the small growing, early varieties. Another means of dealing with corn smut is to cut out the smutted areas and harvest any ear which develops it. The primary insect pests in sweet corn are the corn earworms. They usually feed from the tip of the ears, starting on the silks, then working down to the kernels. Their feeding on the silks will prevent good pollination. Earworm moths are attracted to fresh green silks for egg laying, so in order to control earworms, insecticide needs to be applied to the silks every 3 days until the silks are brown. There are sweet corn varieties available that show some resistance to earworms. The last group of plants we are going to cover are the common perennial vegetables grown in home gardens, asparagus and rhubarb. A good asparagus planting will produce a crop for 15 or 20 years if soil conditions are favorable and good cultural practices are followed. This makes it important to take the extra time at planting to ensure a good stand. Select healthy 1 or 2 year old crowns for starting a new bed. Never dig up and replant old crowns from an old planting. Asparagus crowns should be planted in the early spring. Prepare the furrow 6 to 8 inches deep and wide enough to accommodate the roots. The furrows should be 3 to 4 feet apart. Organic matter should be worked into the bottom of the furrow and space the crowns 12 to 18 inches apart in furrows that are 3 to 4 feet apart. Make sure the buds are facing up and spread the roots out in all directions. Do not fill in the entire furrow at once. After planting, cover the crowns with only 2 inches of soil. As the shoots grow, more soil should be added until the furrow is filled. Gradually filling the furrow allows the buds to grow to the surface without smothering them. By the middle of the summer, the furrow should be completely filled in. The plant should be well established before any spears are harvested. The ferns should be allowed to grow, and no spears should be cut the first year. Harvest should only last 2 weeks the second year. Limiting the harvest the first 2 or 3 years after harvest will allow the plants to become well established. Once established, asparagus can be harvested through mid-June. Discontinue harvesting at this time will allow the plants to develop strong, healthy fern growth and store enough food reserves in the crown for next year's production. Weeds can be a major problem in asparagus production. In an established plantings, a thorough tilling before spring growth begins is a helpful control measure. several herbicides have been labeled for asparagus in recent years. These can be expected to give good results if carefully applied at the proper time. See the table of herbicides in PM 994 for recommended products, rates, and timing of the applications. Common salt has been used to prevent weed growth in asparagus beds. However, it is not recommended, nor is it effective in thoroughly controlling the weeds in asparagus. Continued application of salts to the soil may eventually cause undesirable soil structure and reduce the stand and yields in future years. It is recommended to leave the fern growth standing through the winter to catch and hold the snow on the bed. This prevents deep freezing and sudden changes in soil temperature. The dried ferns can be removed the following spring before growth resumes. Some gardeners complain that their asparagus produces thin, small spears. This can be attributed to several factors. Inadequate fertilization and poor drainage may result in poor quality spears. Also, immature or over-harvested plants will produce small spears. If a planting is producing small, thin spears, harvesting should be discontinued for the remainder of the season to allow the plant to build up food reserves in the crown for next year's crop. Rhubarb is another perennial crop often grown in home gardens. Like asparagus, it needs a period of 2 to 3 years after planting to become established before it can be harvested. Also, like asparagus, rhubarb should not be harvested past the middle of June to allow the plant to build up food reserves. Only the rhubarb stalks or petioles should be eaten because the leaves contain moderately poisonous oxalic acid. This toxin does not leak out of the leaves and into the petioles at any time during the growing season. Rhubarb is propagated mainly by dividing existing plant crowns. The plant should be divided in early spring before growth starts and as soon as the soil can be worked. To divide an established plant, dig the clump and separate it into several pieces by cutting down through the crown between the buds. One or two strong buds with 6 to 8 inches of root are all that are needed. Select a planting site that receives full sunlight and provides good water drainage. Set the buds 1.5 to 2 inches below the soil surface. Rhubarb crowns often become overcrowded after 8 to 10 years. When this happens, the plant produces many small shoots and the yield is decreased. This problem can be avoided by dividing the plant. After a plant has been divided, wait 3 years before harvesting again. Seed stalk development is common on rhubarb plants, particularly if it's an old planting or subject to stress conditions. These seed stalks should be removed as soon as they form because they reduce the vigor of the planting. Before we close, there is one last thing we should discuss with this unit, seed quality and storage. It is always a good idea to plant fresh, quality seed each year to ensure good germination. If all possible, purchase only seeds that have been packaged for the current year. Sometimes, though, seed is left over in the package after planting. This excess seed can be saved for next year's garden, usually with little loss in germination, if it's stored properly. Storage temperature, relative humidity, and seed moisture are the important factors in determining how long seeds can be stored. These factors are even more important than the age of the seed in determining the viability, that is, the ability of the seed to germinate. It's best to wait to open the seed packet until planting time. The packet should be closed as soon as possible after the seeds are sown to prevent the seeds from pulling in moisture from the air and to reduce contaminants such as dirt from getting mixed in with the seed. Excess seeds that are not planted need to be protected. This can be done by placing the packets inside of a sealable sandwich or freezer bag. These bags can then be placed inside of jars with the lids tightly sealed. The jar should be placed in a cool area, such as a refrigerator or a cool basement. Most properly stored garden seeds should produce a decent stand of vigorous seedlings the following year. If stored properly, some seeds will remain viable for 5 years or longer. To determine how well your stored seeds will germinate in the garden, you can run a germination test. At random, pick out a minimum of 10 seeds. Place the seeds on several layers of pre-moistened paper towels. Put the seeds on one half of the paper and fold the other half of the paper over them. Then put the paper towels inside a plastic bag and seal it. Place it in a warm location, about 70 to 80 degrees. Some people keep the bag on top of their refrigerator to keep it warm. Label the bag so you will know what seeds it contains. Check the seeds in 2 or 3 days, and every day thereafter for about a week or so. It should not take over 3 weeks for most seed species to germinate. The sign that germination has taken place is when a root emerges from the seed coat. When some seeds have germinated and a week's wait indicates that no more are about to sprout, the germination rate can be calculated. Fresh seed should be purchased if less than 60% of the seeds have germinated. This concludes our formal discussion on vegetable crops. I hope you've picked up some new tips for growing these crops. If you have any questions on the material we covered today, do not hesitate to ask your county extension director or call in with your questions.
And we will try to get back to you if we don't answer your questions during the next few minutes. I think we probably have more questions than we can answer, and we're going to get right to them. I'd like to do questions from the folks out of state first. We got a couple of calls from Mississippi. One on butter beans. The vines are good, the blooms are good, the pods form, but no beans in the pod.
Well,
this is not a butter bean expert here.
I'm not a butter bean expert, and I hate to say, but I really don't know what the answer to that is. The real curious factor in that is that the plant will produce pods and not seeds. Mm-hmm. So there's something either feeding on the seeds or inhibiting that seed that was pollinated to grow. Environmental factors, or it could be insect, and I really can't narrow it down to what, because it's the seed inside a fruit, or in this case the pod, that stimulates the pod to develop. And if the pod is developing, that seed may have been there at one time or another.
Mm-hmm.
But it just sort of either shriveled or something fed on it.
Our garden insect specialist is answering phone calls today, and he thought it might be also be an insect problem.
Right, he suggested perhaps stink bugs, because down there they have a lot of problems with stink bugs, or we really don't up here.
Yeah.
So that's why we don't see that problem very often.
Across country in Oregon, Rhea Asbury is watching in Ashland, Oregon. What vegetables can be grown on a half-acre lot with many oak trees? A garden would be within 20 feet of the oak trees in almost any location.
The main problem is root competition. You try to grow something that really doesn't have a deep root system and something that doesn't produce a fruit. The root crops will grow well in such an area, particularly shade. I'm concerned more about shade mm-hmm. and root competition than the oak tree itself. I mean, any species of tree, anytime you're growing something in shade, you really need to grow a leafy vegetable or a root crop. Those producing fruits, flowers, will not produce a good yield. So stick to the root crops or the leafy vegetables.
Okay.
Or the potatoes or early season crops. Broccoli and cauliflower may do all right also.
Okay. Mary Fieser calls from northwest Wyoming, where it is probably a little warmer day than they've had lately. Anyway, she lives at 7,000 feet, wonders about work that's, has any work been done on potatoes for high altitude? If so, where she get the, she could, where could she get that information? I would suggest she call her extension office.
No, we don't do too much work around here. Our
high
altitude
yeah.
is probably the top of our buildings here. It's the tallest place you'll find in Iowa, or else on the bluffs, I should say, mm-hmm. the east and west part of the state. We really have not done any work, or I'm not familiar with any varieties that are adaptable for this. So I would suggest she contact her
extension office in her state
or her land grant institution in her state to ask them what varieties they recommend, because there probably are varieties for the area and for high altitudes, mm-hmm. but I don't know which ones they are.
Yeah, the Laramie or Cheyenne, wherever the land grant school is a long ways from Moran, Wyoming, but that's probably the best place to go for help, or perhaps you have an extension office in your county, and that would be a place to go. Okay, from Sioux City, this question came in much earlier in the show, and we haven't answered it yet until we had a chance to consult with our plant pathologist, Mark Gleason, who's answering phones also. Wondered about sterilization of garden soil with Vapam, is that right?
Vapam.
And Dexol, does it work? Does it control wilt disease on tomatoes?
Well, that was a tricky question, so we consulted with Mark, and I was familiar with Vapam, but he suggested as the best control, first of all, have your soil
tested to make sure it is a wilt disease that you have or a nematode problem to begin with. Vapam is one product that is recommended for home use. There are others like methylbromide, but that's a restricted use pesticide. I would say be very cautious and make sure you have a serious problem before you try to sterilize your soil. It's a tricky business. You've got to, first of all, apply the product uniformly. You've got to apply it on a soil that doesn't have any clods. It's got to be very smooth in texture, very well tilled, you might say, so that you get coverage, and it's got to be at least 60 degrees. So just about the time you want to be planting all your crops, you're making it before by sterilizing your soil. Also, by sterilizing, you're killing all organisms, beneficial and bad organisms at the same time. So as that occurs, you can get reinfection very rapidly because you don't have the beneficial organisms to attack the harmful organisms. Mm-hmm. So if you have clods of old soil on your equipment, you can take that through and reinfect your entire garden. It'd be best if you use throughout the entire garden if you're going to do it, rather than just strips. Actually, the best thing to do is rotate your crops within the garden and make sure the problems that you think are the problems are really the problems.
Okay.
In other words, I don't recommend it.
Very good. Question about growing tomatoes in containers from Patty in Linn County. Container types, fertilizer, drainage, recommended varieties. That's a lot of information needed in a short period of time, and we do have publications on that.
Yes, that's a good point. We do have a publication entitled Container and Patio Vegetable Gardening, which is adequate in explaining what potting soil mixes you should be using, because there are specific mixes that are recommended for growing vegetables in containers. And it also will tell some of the varieties that are out mm-hmm. in the market. There are a lot of good bush type varieties that are very well adapted to containers anymore. Bush cucumbers, even bush squash. Beans can be grown very well in containers. There are small patio type tomatoes, as well as some of the determinate type tomatoes that can be grown in containers. So I think some of our plant breeders are looking at mm-hmm. these options for the urban gardener. And I think there's a lot of things available, and it can be done relatively successfully.
One of our Linn County master gardeners had peppers and tomatoes in containers on a patio against a wall. The plants received direct sun from 11 in the morning until 6 p.m. The potting mix was black soil, peat, sand with rock in the bottom, and they didn't get any fruit. Why?
Could be a lot of variables involved in that. First of all, they did everything right. Mm-hmm. They had the right potting soil, a good exposure, but it may have been too good. The white walls, if there's a white wall of their home, reflecting down on it, may have been too intense, causing the blossoms to abort. Or perhaps they used a too high of nitrogen fertilizer within their potting soil as they watered, or perhaps initially, mm-hmm. and that caused a lot of vegetative growth and no flower development. They did not indicate whether the plant produced flowers, it just said it didn't produce fruit. If it produced flowers, it was probably high light intensities and very hot situation off that concrete on your patio that caused those blossoms to abort. Now, if there were no blossoms set, it probably was a high nitrogen problem.
Okay. Question about things that we see advertised. Vitamins, enzymes, hormones to boost the yield of tomatoes. Do they work?
No.
Good.
I should justify that comment. Do they work? We have not seen any results that say that they work. You're better off fertilizing, have a complete fertilizer program. Doing it the old-fashioned way may be probably the better way than dealing with some of these synthetic products you spray on the plants.
Okay. A couple of questions about some unusual things. Can kiwi fruit be grown in Iowa? Can you answer that?
You may hear more about that in 2 weeks, but yes, they can be grown here in Iowa. We are putting in a planting out at our horticulture research station this year because we do get a lot of questions on that, particularly one that's offered by, name drop, the Gurney Seed Company now. It's called the Hardy Kiwi.
Mm-hmm.
It can be grown. It needs to be trellised. What little we know about it is that there are male and female plants, so you need to buy at least two plants, and they'll sell you two plants. They're real good about indicating. Of course, they're going to sell you more plants that way, so they tell you you need at least a male and a female to produce a crop. You need to have it trellised, and it comes into production about the same time as a dwarf tree would, 2 to 3 years perhaps later, depending on the culture. Full sun, well-drained soil. They're not the size or the appearance of your kiwi fruits that we ship in from New Zealand. So be prepared if you're going to grow them for something that looks just a little different, perhaps the size of a large pecan. So they're a little bit smaller. Again, we are going to put in a trial out at our research station so we can get a closer look at it and practice on some of the pruning techniques, because we really don't know that much about them.
Okay, from Creston, why can't we grow celery in Iowa?
We can, but we don't get the success that we'd get if we were growing it in Michigan.
Because of the growing season.
Right. Our growing season is our spring growing season. We have a fairly long growing season, but our spring growing season here in Iowa amounts to about 3 weeks, really, where we get moderate cool nights, 60 to 70 degree days, a lot of sunshine. This is optimum for celery, and our temperatures get too hot too fast.
Yeah.
Plus, the celery needs to be blanched. Many people will grow celery and not blanch them, so they result in these bitter, strong, very strong flavored green stalks. To blanch celery, we need to put something around the base of them. You can either mound soil up, but then you get dirty celery. Some people have found that they can take a half-gallon plastic or paper milk cartons that they put over the celery stalks about midway through the season, so that that celery stalk comes up above, the foliage is up above the milk carton, but that blanch it to reduce that strong flavor. There are certain varieties that you can find in our recommended vegetable list that I would try if you're going to attempt to grow celery. Again, you can find celery transplants at your garden centers.
Okay. We almost need an extra half hour for all the questions. We'll see if we can get through one or two more here in the time we have left. Can you grow your own onion sets? Jerry Crosser from Des Moines wants to know.
Onion sets I wouldn't work with. I'd work more with onion transplants.
Okay.
As far as sets, what you need to do is do a late planting the following fall, the previous fall, and overwinter those. And I would say I wouldn't waste my time with it. But right now, we can start growing our onion transplants for a real good crop for this season. Start direct seeded indoors as you would transplants, and it'll take a couple weeks for that seedling to emerge. And they'll emerge like little spears of grass. They'll look very unusual, and we need about 8 to 10 weeks. What I recommend is starting at least 10 weeks before you plant, and then go in after the seedlings are about 3 inches tall and give them a haircut down to about 2 inches tall. As they grow, you might want to cut them back again, and then plant them out very early spring as soon as the soil can be worked. The little seedlings may look quite stressed at first, but they usually come around and produce a very good crop, providing you give them plenty of room to grow.
Got about a minute and a half left. Another quick one. The mini vegetables that we see, are they special varieties or just immature plants?
They're both. Many of the restaurants will serve you these mini vegetables right now. There are a lot of varieties that are coming out, like little fingers, lady fingers, carrots. There are some green beans now on the market that are small or immature. The little sweet corn that you see in some of the oriental dishes are immature sweet corn heads, or ears, I should say, not heads. And there are certain varieties that do best for that, and of which I do not know. But they could either be immature or they could be these special varieties. I'd prefer, if you're going to grow these mini vegetables, select the varieties that are best used for these, such as the lady fingers or the little fingers carrots.
Okay, one more question. I think we have time. Rabbit and squirrel problems, they're eating perennial flowers in this case. What can they do other than fence?
Fence is the best way.
Yeah.
It's always the best way. Some people recommend mothballs. They're not real effective.
Okay.
Probably if you're going to use an organic control, blood meal would be your second best option next to a fence. However, you've got to reapply that after every rainfall because it disappears, and it is quite expensive. Unfortunately, that is a real problem.
Okay, yeah, that certainly is. And again, I think fencing is probably your best bet. I have a few more questions, but we don't have time, and we will try to get back to you if we do have your name and address or phone number in the next week or two to answer those. Otherwise, ask the folks that help you in your local extension offices. Gail Nanicki, who's our small fruit specialist here at Iowa State University, will be back with us in 2 weeks to talk about growing apples and strawberries and lots of other things. And we will see you then.
And on the same channel.
On the same channel, right here, on the same satellite and channel. We'll see you then. Have a good time as Master Gardener trainees. Take care. And I'm Roger Brown.